loved me and gave himself for me.
The passage that Fritz just read for us from Galatians 2 is a well-known passage. We have songs based on that passage. It's a passage that I suspect many of us may have memorized. And I think it's a passage that has that kind of popularity because in it, Paul found a way to simply yet evocatively describe his relationship with Jesus. And even though Paul had a very special and intimate relationship with Jesus, he didn't believe it was unique to him. It's one that he thought others should share with him. For example, he wrote to the Corinthians that they were to imitate him even as he imitated Christ. He wrote something very similar to the Philippian Christians in Philippians chapter 3, that they were to join him in imitating Jesus. Paul thought that all Christians should have that same kind of devoted relationship with Jesus that he had. Now, it's one thing for us to recognize the relationship that Paul had and to understand that it was his expectation that other Christians have a similar relationship. And it's different to know what that looks like in practice. In my experience, lots of people recognize the expectation of a relationship with Jesus, but sometimes they struggle to know what that relationship looks like in practice. So for a few minutes this morning, we're going to look at Paul's letter to the Christians in the city of Philippi. Because in that letter, Paul spends some time using his life as an example of what it looks like when one devotes themselves to Jesus. So we want to see the kinds of things that Paul pointed to in his life that were products of his relationship with Jesus, and then try and take from that some applications that we can apply to our lives as we work to be more and more like Jesus. So let's take a moment and pray before we consider Paul's message in Philippians. Father, we are thankful that you have united us as a family. We're thankful for all of the blessings that we enjoy, our families, the safeties and securities that are offered to us in our nation, all of the material blessings that allow us to have things like this building. We recognize that most important, we have a relationship with you through Jesus. Help us to focus ourselves on your Son. Help us to think about his life and his teachings, to consider how we can be more like him in how we think and how we act. And we pray that you'll continue to be patient with us and merciful to us and forgiving to us when we struggle and when we fail. And we pray that the mercy that you show to us, we will show to others, that we will extend to them the same forgiveness and the same patience that you shower on us. We ask all this through Jesus. Amen. If you have a Bible with you this morning, whether it's a digital one or a physical one, either open it up, turn it on to Philippians. We will spend our time in Philippians this morning. A number of places in Paul's writings, he talks about his life prior to meeting Jesus. And in those passages, there are a number of times where Paul talks about before he met Jesus, he was a very devout person. He talked, for example, in Galatians chapter 1 about the kind of devotion that characterized his life prior to meeting Jesus. In Philippians, for example, in Philippians chapter 3, Paul spent some time describing some of the things that were part of his life before meeting Jesus. He said in that section in Philippians 3, verses 5 and 6, that before meeting Jesus, he was a Hebrew of Hebrews. It was his way of saying, as far as religious Jews go, he was one of the most religious. He said, as far as matters of God's law were concerned, he was a Pharisee. He was part of that small group of individuals who devoted themselves to understanding and obeying God's law. And as far as righteousness, he said, he was blameless in regard to the law. Paul was a very devout individual. But when he met Jesus, his encounter radically changed his devotion. In his comments to the Galatian Christians, he said that his devotion shifted away from the traditions of his fathers to center on Jesus and the relationship that Jesus enabled him to have with God. And the ways in which Jesus changed his focus prepared him to receive the commission that we read Jesus announcing he was going to give to Paul in Acts chapter 9. He chose Paul to be a special and chosen instrument who would carry his name before the Gentiles, before kings, as well as before the Israelites. And that commission that Jesus gave to Paul included a number of missionary journeys that Paul went on. We read about those in Luke's book of Acts. In Paul's second missionary journey, we read in Acts 16, he stopped in the city of Philippi. And Luke records quite a bit of information about Paul's time in Philippi when compared to the other places that he records him stopping. But we don't get a whole lot of information about the relationship that Paul had with the people in Philippi, the church that he helped establish there. However, when we go to the book of Philippians and we read the comments that Paul makes to the Christians in the city, the church that he helped establish when he stopped there, as Luke records in Acts 16, we find that Paul felt warmth and gratitude. He felt a closeness to those Christians. That's part of the letter that he wrote to them. For example, part of the connection he felt to the Philippian Christians came because they shared a mutual commitment to Jesus. They had a devotion to Jesus that Paul felt was like the one he had to Jesus. And also, he felt a connection to them because, as he comments in chapter 1, they were going through similar experiences of persecution like Paul was going through. There was a closeness to the Christians in Philippi and to Paul that in part motivated them to share with Paul their resources, their time, to send individuals like Epaphroditus to him with help and support when he was in prison. And when we read through this letter, we find it resonating with the closeness that Paul felt towards those individuals. And so he's writing to them because of the situation they were in. Look, for example, in Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, verse 29. Paul said to the Philippian Christians that it had been granted to them for the sake of Christ that they should not only believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. Engaged in the same conflict that you saw I had, and now here that I still have. And when Paul's writing this letter, he's writing from prison. We see this, for example, in verse 13 of the same chapter. Paul was experiencing some extreme difficulties. In fact, as he writes through this, he wasn't entirely sure whether he would die in prison or be released. Yet he heard the Philippians were going through something similar to what he was going through, and so he wrote a letter to them to offer them encouragement, to offer them guidance, to encourage them to live in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, as he mentions in verse 27 of chapter 1, the appropriate response to the hostilities that they're encountering. And to help them understand what that worthy response looks like, Paul held out his life as an example. In chapter 3 and verse 17, he told the Philippian Christians to join in imitating him. So it was his understanding that they could gain insight into the ways that they're supposed to act by reflecting on his own example and following the pattern of his life. So I want us to consider six passages in the book of Philippians in which Paul talks about the ways in which Jesus had reshaped his life, changed his thinking, and changed his behavior. And after we look at those six passages, we want to draw a few applications from that, things that Paul said should be part of the lives of the Philippian Christians and that we can also work to make part of our own lives. The first passage that we're going to look at, Philippians chapter 1 and verse 18. Now, verse 18 is a concluding thought in a small section there that begins in verse 15 by Paul acknowledging that there were some people who were preaching the gospel, preaching about Jesus out of envy and rivalry. And these individuals that were preaching out of envy and rivalry, he says in verse 17, were doing it in hopes that it would make Paul's imprisonment even harder. They were doing it thinking that it would afflict him in his imprisonment. Verse 18 describes Paul's response to those individuals who were preaching about Jesus with the hope that it would make Paul's imprisonment harder. This is what he said. What then? What is my response to these individuals? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Paul's relationship with Jesus radically altered his thoughts about himself. His concern wasn't centered on his own physical well-being or the ways that people honored him. Rather, his focus was that people heard about Jesus. And even if the way they heard about it was through individuals who intentionally and maliciously trying to hurt him, Paul said, I'll rejoice in that because even though I'm hurt in this exchange, it gives people a chance to hear about Jesus. And Paul told the Philippian Christians, imitate me and these kinds of things. A second passage, still in chapter 1 of Philippians, this time in verse 20. Paul, in Philippians chapter 1, announced that he was writing from prison back in verse 13, talks about his imprisonment. And I don't suspect any of us would want to be in prison today, but the prisons that we're familiar with, the prison system that we have, is very, very different from the ones that would have been a part of Paul's world. The kinds of protections for prisoners were not part of the world within which Paul lived. And so imprisonment would have been a significantly harder, harsher experience. And notice what he says in chapter 1 and verse 20, writing about his imprisonment. And as he's commenting here, he's not sure that he'll make it out of prison alive. He suspects he might because he feels like there's a need for him in the world, but he's not sure that he won't die in prison. But notice what he has to say as he's thinking about his imprisonment and the risks to his life. Philippians 1 verse 20. As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not at all, that I will not be at all ashamed, but with full courage now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. His concern wasn't for his own well-being primarily. It wasn't that he would find peace and freedom and security and health and happiness. His concern was that he would live in ways that would bring honor to Jesus, even if it meant his death. Paul was radically transformed by his encounter with Jesus. It changed every part of his thinking about himself. A third passage, this one in Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 and 8. In this section, Paul is responding to people that were trying to undermine him. When we read through Paul's various writings, we find there were a group of individuals that were constantly undermining Paul's ministry, the impact that Paul had on people. And one of the ways that it seems they tried to do this was to attack his credibility, to say, well, Paul is making himself out to be something that he's really not. And it seems that one of the things they try to do was to discredit his connection to the law of Moses. Well, he's not a good Jew, so he can't really believe the things that he's saying. And in the section, Paul responds to some of those evildoers, he comments, some of those dogs as he describes them in verse 2. And he describes his own past, his life before he encountered Jesus. And it's in the section he talks about some of the marks of success as some people in his society might have seen it. He was a Pharisee, he was zealous, he was blameless as far as the law went. But notice what Paul had to say about his current thought to all those things that might normally have be seen as occasions of pride in his world. Verse 7 and verse 8. Whatever gain I had, I count it as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I've suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ. Paul found a surpassing worth in Jesus. And the value of Jesus was so great that everything else in his life he considered to be garbage in comparison to Jesus. His concern did not orient itself on the kinds of markers that people tend to focus on in the world. Rather, Paul's life focused on the value of Jesus, and he tried to orient his life around that value by cultivating a relationship with Jesus as Jesus desired it. In Philippians 3, this time look at verse 10. A fourth thing that we notice from Paul's life. In Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, Paul talks about, as he's moving out of this conversation about those individuals that were attacking him, his credibility, his authority as an apostle, he moves beyond that to talk more broadly about the focus and the goal of his life. In Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, Paul writes that his goal was to know Jesus and the power of his resurrection, that he could share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. Paul's focus was so fixed on Jesus that he considered even following after Jesus' example of suffering something to be desired. It's a profound shift. That's not normally the way people think in our world. People don't normally desire to suffer and experience hardships like Jesus endured. But Paul says his focus on Jesus was so pronounced that he considered it worthwhile in knowing Jesus to even go through the kinds of sufferings that Jesus himself went through. And this was driven by his anticipation of what would come after his life, the life that follows this life. Still in Philippians chapter 3, this time look in verse 13 and verse 14. Paul wrote to the Philippian Christians that he has forgotten what lies behind and was straining forward to what lies ahead. He said, "I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." And so he encouraged the Philippian Christians, to those of you who are mature, think like him. And verse 17, to join in imitating him. There was a value in Jesus that went beyond merely the immediate circumstances of his life. It held hope for a future reality that reframed Paul's thoughts about his life in the present. And then finally, in chapter 4, verses 11 through 13, in this section, beginning in verse 10, Paul responds to the Philippian Christians who heard about his imprisonment. And even though they were experiencing hostility, even though Paul said they were going through sufferings like he himself was going through, when they heard about Paul's ordeals, they were so concerned, they gathered funds and resources and they sent them in the care of an individual named Epaphroditus, sending him to Paul to help Paul in his imprisonment with money, with resources, and with the aid that that individual would offer to Paul. And so Paul praises the Philippian Christians for their concern for him. But notice what he said as he's responding to their care for him. In Philippians 4, beginning verse 11, he said, "I'm not speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I've learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me." Paul's contentment, the profound contentment that he experienced, was not based merely on the circumstances of his life, but on the relationship he had with Jesus. And even though he was grateful to Philippian Christians, he reminded them that their help did not make him a content person. Jesus alone secured his contentment. And these insights that Paul offers into his life in his letter to Philippians were designed to offer them perspective as they were going through similar ordeals like Paul. He encouraged them in chapter 3 and verse 17 to imitate him, to join him in his focus on Jesus. And the expectation as he's writing to them is the things he was saying about himself would come to be realities in the lives of the Philippian Christians. And as we think about Paul's expectation the Philippians would join in imitating him, and the things that defined his life would come to define their life, we begin to see some essential characteristics that attend being a follower of Jesus. Things that were part of Paul's life, part of Paul's writings, that it was his understanding needed to be part of his life and needed to characterize the lives of all people who follow Jesus. And we are a church family that's working to be more and more like Jesus. And so as people like Paul who are working to fix ourselves on Jesus, here are some of the characteristics that are part of that Jesus-centered focus. If we're going to be people who commit like Paul to following Jesus, then our lives have to be characterized by things like humble selflessness. In Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, Paul talks about the selflessness that comes from being a follower of Jesus. And this selflessness is one that comes from the example of Jesus. Just as Jesus gave up everything that was part of his station in heaven to come here and serve humans, to die for humans, Paul said humans should similarly give up to serve others. Followers of Jesus put the concerns of others ahead of their own concerns. And this is not merely some religious nicety. This has profound and difficult expectations attached to it. For example, in 1 Corinthians chapters 8 through 10, Paul talks about situations where there are differences of opinion, in which there are people who are weaker and people who are stronger. In situations where there's differences of opinion, Paul says that we are to put the opinions of others ahead of our own opinions. It's challenging, deeply challenging. It becomes even more challenging when we consider some of the ways in which Jesus taught about this. Consider, for example, the end of Matthew chapter 5, the relationship Jesus said one should have with their enemies. The humble selflessness that attends a life following Jesus is one that puts the concerns of others, of everyone, no matter what we might think about them, ahead of our own concerns. It's very, very challenging, but it's essential to being a follower of Jesus. And it's one of the things we see that defined the life of Paul. A second characteristic that attends being a follower of Jesus is peacefulness. Now, in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 7, Paul talks about a peace that passes understanding that God gives to Christians, that secures their minds and gives them peace in this life. But that's not the peace that Paul talks about most in his writings. Look, for example, in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 14. After talking about how the Philippian Christians were to follow the example of Jesus' selflessness, he says in verse 14, "Do all things without grumbling or disputing, so that you may be blameless and innocent, children of God without blemish, in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation." When he talks about doing things without grumbling and disputing, he's talking about being peaceful people. But it's important we think about the nature of this peacefulness. It's not merely a peace that one experiences because of their relationship with God, but it's peace in one's relationships with the people around them that they actively cultivate by not grumbling, by not disputing, but living in intentional peace with all of the people around them. Now, my suspicion is, you've lived around humans and you realize how difficult that is. It's challenging to be at peace with all people. But Paul said it's a hallmark of being a follower of Jesus. And it's important we understand the peace he talks about in chapter 4, the peace that God gives, and the peace he says ought to be part of our relationships with one another in Philippians chapter 2 are inseparably connected together. Consider, for example, in Matthew 22 when Jesus talked about the greatest commands, love God and love others. Those two are inseparably tied together and form the foundation of everything that God expects. And those two greatest commands become the basis for experiencing the peace that passes understanding that God gives and the peace that characterizes our relationships with one another. When we love God and are devoted to Him, He extends that peace that passes understanding to us. And when we love God, we love our brothers and sisters next to us. And so we seek relationships that are not characterized by grumbling and disputing. That's what it looks like to love your neighbor. A third characteristic that attends being a follower of Jesus that we see in Paul, and we see Paul encouraging to have in the lives of those to whom he wrote, is joyfulness. followers of Jesus experience genuine and abiding joy, not because of the circumstances of their life. Remember, Paul's writing from prison, a situation that he wasn't sure he would escape from with his life. But if you read through the book of Philippians, you find Paul constantly talking about how people should rejoice and be filled with joy. For example, in chapter 3, verse 1, finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. In chapter 4, verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Paul talks about his own rejoicing, and he encouraged the Philippians to rejoice, even though he was in prison and being persecuted by people who were trying to make his imprisonment even worse, and even though the Philippian Christians were enduring difficulties similar to the ones that he was going through. Joyfulness is part of the characteristics that comprise those who follow Jesus, but it's not based merely on the physical circumstances of our lives. Rather, it's based on the relationship we have with Jesus. The relationship that allows us to consider all things lost compared to his surpassing worth. The relationship that allows us to experience contentment regardless of what circumstances we might find ourselves in. Therein lies real joy that allows us to pursue good in this world, even though it might sometimes result in difficulties and hardships for us. Because joy is located in our relationship with Jesus rather than any other circumstance of our lives. And because there's that kind of joyfulness, there's also attendant hopefulness. Hopefulness and joyfulness go together. Because there's hope through our relationship with Jesus, there's also joy. This hope that we find Paul talking about in Philippians chapter 3, beginning in verse 20, as he writes to the Christians in that city about their citizenship. He writes in Philippians 3, verse 20, our citizenship is in heaven. Now, it's important we think about this idea of citizenship in heaven. In the Roman world, citizenship as a Roman citizen was incredibly valuable. It guaranteed freedoms and protections that were rare in the ancient world. The Philippians, the people that lived in the city of Philippi, not necessarily Roman citizens, but they were a free city and given many of the freedoms and the rights a Roman citizen would have. Having a claim of citizenship in the city of Philippi was a big deal. But Paul, writing to people who had that claim, he says, that's not what's significant. Citizenship in Philippi doesn't matter. What matters is that your citizenship is in heaven, where you have a Savior who rules sovereignly and who will return. And when he does return, verse 21, will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body. It's hope built on the sovereign identity of Jesus and the claims, the promises that God makes that Jesus will set everything right, that he will unite things in heaven and things in earth, that he will establish his kingdom as God promised throughout Scripture. And that hope remains the case for us. We are hopeful, confident people, not because our citizenship is in this country, but because our citizenship is located in Jesus and his kingdom and his rule. And that hopefulness helps bring about the joyfulness that we just mentioned. But there's another characteristic, a fifth one that's very important for us to consider, the characteristic of purity. Being a follower of Jesus carries with it lots of benefits. So we've talked about peacefulness and joyfulness and hopefulness. And those are certainly blessings that attend being a follower of Jesus. But as we've talked about them, they're not merely blessings we receive. They're also expectations for how we behave in the world and in our relationships with others. We experience peace and joy and hope because we are transformed people in the day-to-day realities of our lives. We live as people stamped with the mark of Jesus and his kingdom that allows us to experience those things. And that expresses itself through the purity that is to define followers of Jesus. In the book of Philippians, Paul encourages the Philippians to live in ways that are worthy of their calling, the gospel of Jesus, to live in ways that demonstrates they both understand and submit to the calling of Jesus. And as he works his way through this book, he talks some about what that looks like. For example, in chapter 4, verses 8 and 9, he tells them, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Be people whose lives are focused on good and pure things. The contrast we find earlier, for example, in chapter 2, verse 14 and following, where he talks about don't be like the world. Don't follow the world's pattern of corruption and darkness. Don't follow its crooked paths. Instead, live lives marked by purity that attends those who follow Jesus. So like Paul, if we're going to be people who are focused on Jesus, if like Paul, we're going to be people who are crucified with Christ, there are some very specific characteristics that attend that decision. If we, like Paul, are going to be crucified with Christ, then we're going to be people who are marked by humble selflessness. We're going to be people marked by peacefulness in our relationships with the people around us. We'll be people marked by joy that's not dependent merely on the day-to-day circumstances of our lives. We'll be people marked by hope of what God promises to do through Jesus, and people whose lives are characterized by a purity that comes from our focus on Jesus. If that's not the case in your life, if you're not defined by those characteristics, I would encourage you to consider the calling of Jesus, the expectations of being a follower of him, to reflect on the life of Paul, an individual like us who saw the worth of Jesus and who was working to orient his life around him. If as a church family we can support you, we can encourage you, we can help you, we're ready to do it because we recognize all of us struggle with this. That the world can be an oppressive place that can grind away our devotion to Jesus. But more importantly, we serve a God whose desire is to help us, whose desire is to express his love by showering us with his grace and his mercy, his patience and his love. And because he's that kind of God, we have a chance to be different and redeemed people. We have a chance to know him through Jesus. We have a chance to be given new lives as we reenact Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, a reenactment that is to set the stage for the rest of our life as we continue to reenact the life of Jesus through our day-to-day choices, our day-to-day relationships. Whatever need you might have this morning, you have a chance right now to let it be known by coming forward.